All right, students, today we are looking at chapters 3, 4, and 5 from part 7, the 20th century and beyond of Roger Kamian's Music and Appreciation. So first we're going to talk a little bit about Impressionism and Symbolism, and then we're going to discuss the composers Debussy and Ravel. So starting off here with Impressionism and Symbolism. Many different musical styles coexisted around the beginning of the 20th century. Among the most important was Impressionism, best represented by the music of the French composer Claude Debussy. We look closely at musical Impressionism in section 4, but first, two related, though slightly earlier, artistic movements in France demand our attention: Impressionist painting and Symbolist poetry. In 1874, a group of French painters, including Claude Monet, Auguste Renoir, and Camille Pissarro, had an exhibition in Paris. One painting by Monet, titled Impression Sunrise, a misty scene of boats in port, particularly annoyed an art critic who wrote, "Wallpaper in its embryonic state is more finished than that seascape." Using Monet's title, the critic mockingly called the entire show the exhibition of the Impressionists. The term Impressionist stuck, but it eventually lost its derisive implication. Today, most of us appreciate Impressionist paintings, which colorfully depict the joys of life and the beauties of nature, but during the 1870s, they were seen as formless collections of tiny colored patches, which they are when viewed closely. From a distance, however, the brushstrokes blend and merge into recognizable forms and shimmering colors. Impressionist painters were concerned primarily with effects of light, color, and atmosphere, with impermanence, change, and fluidity. Monet created a series of 20 paintings showing Rouen Cathedral at different times of the day from dawn to dusk. In this series, the cathedral's stone facade is desolidified and looks like colored mist. Many Impressionist painters preferred to work in the open rather than in a studio. They were fascinated by outdoor scenes from contemporary life, picnics in the woods, and crowds on Parisian boulevards. But most of all, the Impressionists were obsessed with water. Using light pastel colors, they depicted the ripples and waves of the ocean and sailboats on the River Seine. As Impressionist painters broke from traditional depictions of reality, writers, called symbolists, rebelled against the conventions of French poetry. Like the painters, poets such as Stéphane Mallarme, Paul Verlaine, and Arthur Rimbaud emphasized fluidity, suggestion, and the purely musical or sonorous effect of the words. "To name an object," insisted Mallarme, "is to suppress three-quarters of the enjoyment of a poem, which is made up of gradually guessing. The dream is to suggest it." Claude Debussy was a close friend of many of the symbolist poets, especially Mallarme, whose poem The Afternoon of a Faun inspired Debussy's most famous orchestral work, which we'll study in a minute. Many poems by Verlaine became texts for Debussy's songs, and more personally, Verlaine's mother-in-law was Debussy's first piano teacher. Impressionist painting and symbolist poetry were an impetus for many developments during the 20th century. Section 4 is going to describe their effect on music. Which brings us to Claude Debussy. The French Impressionist composer Claude Debussy linked the Romantic era with the 20th century. From the early age of 10 until he was 22, he studied at the Paris Conservatory, where his teachers regarded him as a talented rebel. In 1884, he won the prestigious Prix de Rome, which subsidized 3 years of study in Rome, but he left Italy after only 2 years because he lacked musical inspiration away from his beloved Paris. Influences on Debussy's work included several visits to Russia, where he worked as a pianist for Tchaikovsky's patroness, Nadezhda von Meck, and formed a lifelong interest in Russian music. He was also influenced by the Asian music performed at the Paris International Exposition of 1889 and by the ideas and music of Richard Wagner, which were having a profound effect in France and both attracted and repelled him. For years, Debussy led an unsettled life, earning a small income by teaching piano. His friends were mostly writers such as Stéphane Mallarme, whose literary gatherings he attended regularly. He was little known to the musical public and not completely sure of himself, though he composed important work, including his string quartet and the tone poem Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun. But his opera, Pelléas et Mélisande, marked a turning point in his career. Although the critics were sharply divided over it, the opera soon caught on, and Debussy was recognized as the most important living French composer. Debussy led a life filled with financial and emotional crisis, constantly borrowing money, and having tempestuous love affairs. He was not gifted as a conductor and hated appearing in public, but to maintain his high standard of living, he undertook concert tours and presented his music throughout Europe. He died in Paris in 1918. Like the Impressionist painters and Symbolist poets, Debussy evoked fleeting moods and misty atmospheres, as the title of his work suggests. Reflections in the water, clouds, sounds and perfumes swirl in the evening air. Debussy was often inspired by literary and pictorial ideas, and his music sounds free and spontaneous, almost improvised. His stress on tone color, atmosphere, and fluidity is characteristic of Impressionism in music. Tone color truly gets unprecedented attention in Debussy's work. They have a sensuous, beautiful sound and subtle but crucial changes of timbre. The entire orchestra seldom plays together to produce a massive sound. Instead, there are brief but frequent solos. Woodwinds are prominent and strings and brasses are often muted. In his music for piano, which includes some of the finest piano works of the 20th century, he creates hazy sonorities and uses a rich variety of bell and gong-like sounds. Debussy's treatment of harmony was a revolutionary aspect of musical impressionism. He tends to use a chord more for its special color and sensuous quality than for its function in a standard harmonic progression. He uses successions of dissonant chords that do not resolve. He freely shifts a dissonant chord up or down the scale. The resulting parallel chords characterize his style. Debussy's harmonic vocabulary is large. Along with traditional 3- and 4-note chords, he uses 5-note chords with a lush, rich sound. Chord progressions that were highly unorthodox when Debussy wrote them soon came to seem mild and unnatural. "One must drown the sense of tonality," Debussy wrote. Although he never actually abandoned tonality, Debussy weakened it by avoiding chord progressions that would strongly affirm a key and by using scales in which the main tone is not emphasized. He turned to the medieval church modes and the pentatonic or 5-note scales he heard in Javanese music. The pentatonic scale is produced by 5 successive black keys of the piano, for example, F-sharp, G-sharp, A-sharp, C-sharp, and D-sharp. Debussy's most unusual and tonally vague scale is the whole tone scale, made up of 6 different notes, each a whole step away from the next: C, D, E, F-sharp, G-sharp, A-sharp, and back to C. Unlike major or minor, the whole tone scale has no special pull from the 7th to the 8th scale degree because its tones are all the same distance apart, and because no single tone stands out, the whole tone scale creates a blurred, indistinct effect. This rhythmic flexibility reflects the fluid, unaccented quality of the French language, and in fact, he set French to music very sensitively. He composed 59 art songs, many of which are set to Symbolist poems. His opera, Pelléas et Mélisande, is an almost word-for-word setting of a Symbolist play by Maurice Maeterlinck. It is the essence of musical impressionism, nebulous, mysterious, dreamlike, with a discreet, understated orchestral accompaniment. Although not large, Debussy's output is remarkably varied. In addition to his opera and art songs, it includes works for piano, orchestra, and chamber ensembles. Echoes of his music can be heard in the works of many composers during the first 2 decades of the 20th century, but no other important musician can so fairly be described as an impressionist. Even the composer most similar to him, his younger French contemporary Maurice Ravel, who we'll study in a second, wrote music with greater clarity of form. Debussy's style was both a final expression of Romanticism and the beginning of a new era. "The music of this prelude," wrote Debussy of his Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun, "is a free illustration of the beautiful poem by Stéphane Mallarmé, The Afternoon of a Faun. This poem evokes the dreams and erotic fantasies of a pagan forest creature who is half man, half goat. While playing a long solo on his flute, the intoxicated faun tries to recall whether he actually carried off 2 beautiful nymphs or only dreamed of doing so. Exhausted by the effort, he falls back to sleep in the sunshine." Debussy intended his music to suggest the successive scenes through which pass the desires and dreams of the faun in the heat of this afternoon. The subtle, sensuous timbres of the miniature tone poem were new in Debussy's day. Woodwind solos, muted horn calls, and harp glissandos create a rich variety of delicate sounds. The dynamics are usually subdued, and only rarely does the entire orchestra, from which trombones, trumpets, and timpani are excluded, play at one time. The music often swells sensuously and then subsides in voluptuous exhaustion. The prelude begins with an unaccompanied flute melody. Its vague pulse and tonality make it dreamlike and improvisatory. This flute melody is heard again and again, faster, slower, and against a variety of lush chords. Though the form of the prelude may be thought of as A, B, A prime, one section blends with the next. It has a continuous ebb and flow. The fluidity and weightlessness typical of Impressionism are found in this music. We are never tempted to beat time to its subtle rhythms. The prelude ends magically with the main melody played by muted horns seeming to come from far off. The bell-like tones of antique cymbals finally evaporate into the silence. With all its new sounds and musical techniques, the piece has aptly been described as a quiet revolution in the history of music. And now we'll have a listen to a little bit of the first A section of Debussy's Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun. Okay, there's about the first half of Prelude of the Afternoon of a Faun. You can listen to the piece in its entirety on your own. Next up, we talk about one of Debussy's contemporaries, Maurice Ravel. The French composer Maurice Ravel was a master of orchestral and pianistic tone color. Like his older contemporary Debussy, Ravel grew up in Paris and studied piano and composition for many years at the Paris Conservatory. But unlike Debussy, Ravel never succeeded in winning the Prix de Rome, despite five attempts. His last failure, at the age of 30, when he was already a recognized composer, caused a scandal that led to a change of administration at the conservatory. It was perhaps owing to his lingering resentment of the musical establishment that he refused the Legion of Honor when it was offered to him as France's most famous living composer in 1920. Though he is often described as an impressionist and paired with Debussy, Ravel does not fit neatly into any stylistic category. It is true that some of his music, such as the piano piece Fountains and the ballet Daphne and Chloe, has the fluid, misty, atmospheric quality associated with Impressionism, and subtle changes of tone color are indeed extremely important in Ravel's works, as in the Impressionist music of Debussy. Yet much music by Ravel is too clearly defined in form and tonality and classically balanced in phrase structure to be considered Impressionist. His lyrical melodic lines, though individual in style, are closely related to the melodies by 19th century French composers such as Georges Bizet. However, Ravel's melodies are often based on modes, which sometimes make them suggest music from a foreign land or from the distant past. His music is often characterized by a clear beat, and rhythmic patterns are often obsessively repeated. Ravel had a taste for exotic musical idioms. Many of his works have a Spanish flavor. Some examples of that are the Spanish Hour and the orchestral works Spanish Rhapsody and Bolero. He exploited the rhythms and tone colors of American jazz in such works of the 1920s as Piano Concerto in G Major, Piano Concerto for the Left Hand, which was commissioned by one-armed pianist Paul Wittgenstein, and the blues movement of Sonata for Violin and Piano. Ravel was also fascinated by dance and wrote several ballets, including Daphne and Chloe, which he later arranged as two concert suites for orchestra, and stylized dance rhythms pervade much of his music. One of the best known of all orchestral works, Bolero reflects Ravel's fascination with tone color, Spanish music, and obsessive rhythmic repetition. It originated as a ballet commissioned by the dancer Ida Rubinstein and was introduced by her at the Paris Opera in 1928. Set in a dimly lit Spanish cafe, the ballet centers on a young gypsy woman dancing a bolero on a table surrounded by men. Her movements become increasingly lively, and the excitement and tension of the onlookers culminate in violence. The ballet was a success, but soon Bolero became more famous internationally as a concert piece. After its American premiere by Arturo Toscanini in the New York Philharmonic in 1929, a critic wrote that Bolero brought shouts and cheers from the audience. Ravel modestly described Bolero as an experiment consisting of one long, very gradual crescendo. Its theme and rhythm were deliberately given a Spanish character and repeated to the point of obsession. Bolero is unusual in form, consisting of an extended, exotic-sounding theme that is heard over and over with increasingly rich and brilliant orchestration. Ravel creates movement and growth through change of tone color, as Stravinsky does in the Firebird Suite and the Rite of Spring. The theme is first presented by solo woodwind instruments, including the unusual oboe d'amore, which is lower than the oboe, but higher than the English horn. As the volume gradually increases, brass instruments and tenor and soprano saxophones, rare in a symphony orchestra, are given the theme. Novel tone colors result from unusual doublings, such as muted trumpet and flute, as though Ravel were inventing new instruments. Sometimes the melody is doubled at different pitch levels, a device that results in sliding parallel chords. Only after the dynamic level has reached forte is the melody presented by the violins and doubled by woodwinds and brasses. Bolero's accompaniment is even more obsessive than its melody. From beginning to end, a two-bar bolero rhythmic pattern is repeated in the snare drum, which is progressively doubled by more and more instruments. Moreover, in the bass of virtually every bar, we hear a three-note ostinato played pizzicato by the lower strings. Also contributing to the hypnotic effect is the insistence on the key of C major, which persists until an electrifying climax, resulting from a sudden momentary upward shift to the higher key of E major and a violently dissonant ending. And now we'll listen to the first little bit of Bolero by Maurice Ravel, written in 1928. Okay, I think you get the idea there. All right, that does it for the Impressionist. Next time, we'll talk about neoclassicism and Igor Stravinsky. We'll hope to see you then.